please.
Yeah.
Por favor.
Nice little David Ubben retweet. Thanks, pal.
Appreciate the love.
And a Land Thieves retweet. Interesting. My good friends at Land Thieves.
Oh, man.
The Oklahoma blog.
I know.
They like me. It's weird. Oklahoma, I got a really heavy Oklahoma following and a really heavy Oklahoma State following.
Okay.
Which is odd for somebody who covers football in Texas. All right, so you need Mr. Ubben's phone number. Let me read it aloud. You ready? It. That'd be kind of funny, actually. And I emailed Jeff Hulme, and he will be calling you.
Okay.
On your weird phone number. What are you doing?
The computer's doing the freezing thing.
And then we got the Mr. Way. It is really astonishing how much Craig Way knows about high school football. Like,
he is a magical wizard.
He is. He's the Bill Snyder of high school football.
Bill Snyder, yeah.
How much of the A&M game did you watch? Some.
I'd say 60%.
Yeah.
I was slipping between that and all the other games going on then.
Man.
It was disappointing, like most A&M games this year.
That just strikes me as a team that should be way better. The talent is... I don't know, man.
You get no argument for me.
But the problem is, and we'll talk about this when we go live, but...
Are we going live today?
We'll do it live. For me, the biggest issue... It's not an amount of talent thing.
Sure.
It's that there's like one or two spots
where
they know they can be exploited. Linebackers.
Yeah.
You know, the offensive line to a certain extent. Uh-oh. That doesn't look like a fun...
It's fine. The thing just keeps having heart attacks.
Seems like a bad idea. We should change out helmets. Well, we'll do it tomorrow. We don't have time right now.
Just keeps freezing.
You know who we should have at some point on the show?
Everyone?
Old Bill Connolly.
Oh, sure. Yeah.
He'd be a fun interview.
Yeah, that would be fun.
I definitely burped on the air.
Okay.
Friday night.
That's okay.
It's really
That's
funny.
Exciting.
It's really funny. I would say this is a very handsome lineup as well.
Sure. If that's what you go for.
All Okay, so my cousin had a baby.
Sure.
What relation am I to that baby?
Your family.
That's not helpful.
I'm not a helpful person.
Second cousin, is that what that is? They're my second cousin.
I feel like if you don't know what the answer to something is, you're just automatically a second cousin.
It's like the default.
That's my theory.
It's like your mother's sister's ex-husband.
Basically.
Second. Okay, so that's why you know? Okay. Mom's. Well, no, that's different. Mom's cousin's son. So I have a cousin named Tyler. Hi, Tyler and Allie. Congratulations. You're not watching, but. And they had a daughter this weekend. So my cousin, Tyler, is now a dad. What relation am I to Nora, which is the second cousin?
Everyone's a second cousin.
Is that right? I'm going to ask Twitter.
I think he's right. I just think the answer is always second cousin.
Does Allie have Twitter?
Huh. Well, this isn't good. We may not have any artwork or guest phoner stuff today.
Oh no, graphics not
helping
you.
No, the computer won't connect to the network.
Oh no. Okay. I guess I just better not make faces while.
I got nothing right now.
Like whenever Craig Way says something, I shouldn't be like, "Oh."
I don't really know what my solution is.
Well, it's noon.
I put it back two minutes.
You're a cheater. If you're watching the pre-show, Max is lying to you about the time. It is noon right now. We should be starting the show right now, and we are not. So Max dialed back the timing thing to 2 minutes. What a big jerk.
I didn't really fix it.
If you're watching and there are no graphics, it's because we're having technical difficulties.
I'm going to attempt to go old school with it, so.
Oh, well, look at you.
Yeah, we'll see.
Look at you. I don't know about you. It's exhausting hating all these teams.
I love all the teams. I'm the opposite of you.
No.
That's why everyone likes me.
I hate everyone's favorite team. It's in my Twitter profile. I really do.
All right, let's get this thing started.
Let's rock and roll.
We'll be right back.
Yes, yes, y'all. It is DCTF Live, episode number 16. It is Monday, November 9th, 2015. My name is Greg Tepper, managing editor of Dave Campbell's Texas Football and TexasFootball.com. Thank you for tuning in over there with all of the gadgets and gizmos and the stuff that keeps us on the air and puts us on the air. Waving to the camera is Max Thompson.
What's going on, Greg?
I saw you yesterday on a weekend, and it's weird.
Super weird.
Yeah. We had to get together to work on playoff stuff. TexasFootball.com/playoffs.
Are the playoffs starting?
TexasFootball.com/playoffs.
The playoffs are starting!
TexasFootball.com/playoffs for all things Texas High School Football playoffs. Brackets, predictions, all that fun stuff. So, yeah, we had to get together, and I met your folks, which feels like a real step in our relationship.
And they all like, and my wife. And
well, no,
what
I know,
you'd met her,
I admit
but they all spent enough time around you to sort of assess your character, and it's a little disturbing how much they like you.
Woo!
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right. I'm very likable.
He's so funny.
He's funny.
He's
man.
Just the funniest.
You know what? He's really charming.
Yeah.
He's really charming.
No one said charming.
Yeah, they did.
There was nothing.
I bugged
about,
the, I bugged
nothing
the house.
About being charming.
I bugged the house. I heard what you guys were talking about.
That was not true.
So I do. I have a question, and if you know the answer, get it to us on hashtag DCTF
Live. Can I just stop here for a second?
Yeah, sure.
Just what is this? Is this this new position in the chair for you? Like lean back, hide in the corner.
Can I not do this anymore? I can.
No, I mean you're more than welcome
I can lean
to.
Forward
it's
if you
it's
need
just
to.
A
okay. I'll lean
it's
forward.
A departure from the usual.
Yeah, I got to get more comfortable. Now that we're on episode 16.
Sure.
So I have a question. Okay. I posted this on Twitter. If you know the answer, hashtag DCTF Live. Is how you can get in touch with the show.
Right.
Hashtag DCTF Live. So my cousin, Tyler.
Oh, here we go.
And his lovely wife, Allie, had a baby this weekend.
Mm-hmm.
Little Nora.
Right.
She's very cute. Thank God she takes after her. And I'm wondering, mm-hmm. what relation am I to that baby?
Mm-hmm.
That am I an uncle? Am I a second cousin? Am I a cousin once removed?
Greg only asks the important questions.
I don't know what I am.
I
like,
maintain.
How do I refer to Nora?
I maintain that if you don't know, you're probably a second cousin.
You think that?
I just think it's the default.
That's the catch-all.
That's the default.
Yeah.
You're just a second cousin. If you're not sure what you are, you're a second cousin.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. All right, that's fine.
I'm willing to listen to counter arguments.
I just want
to
know. I'm sure there's a right answer.
Sure.
I have no idea what it
right.
is. I've gotten some responses on Twitter that, loyal Tepper follower DJ Rookie Bear says that it might be a Mexican thing, but we just call parents' cousins, aunt
uh-huh.
or uncle.
Okay.
Which. Makes sense. I don't think that's. I don't think that's a.
I'm telling you,
thing
at
based
some point,
on
everyone
demographic.
Just goes with catch-alls.
Second cousin.
Yeah.
I don't
I'm
know.
Telling
but
you.
Anyway, Tyler and Allie, congratulations. She's very pretty. Okay. So there was some football this weekend. I don't know if you know that. We've got. Oh, I should mention we have a big show. A really big show.
Do we have a big show?
We do. Here in just a little bit, we'll be joined by David Ubben, Big 12. Superstar
maestro.
Insider, maestro.
We another guru, if you will.
Another guru. But
yet
we,
another guru.
But I don't
want to
over. But I don't
want to
overuse the word guru because
I'm fine using it.
We've definitely
when it,
got
when
another,
it applies and it applies.
Okay, maestro. I like though. Then we're going to be joined by Mansfield head coach Jeff Hulme. He's got the Tigers roaring into the playoffs. Going to talk with him, and then we will be joined by a real guru. As you said, the wizard of Texas high school football.
The wizard.
It's Craig Way, voice of the Longhorns, but also the host of High School Scoreboard Live on Fox Sports Southwest. So you want to stick around for this. This is it's going to be a big show. But there was football this weekend, and we'll start with our three and outs. We'll start in college, And the big headline from across the weekend, number one, it's got to be TCU. Their loss. They go to Stillwater, and I mean, I don't know if I'm necessarily surprised that they lost. I'm surprised they played
they
that poorly.
Smoked. They got smoked.
I mean, Oklahoma State took the fight to them, and it TCU. And what's funny, and I wrote about this on TexasFootball.com, but we had a book kind of on what Oklahoma State wanted to do offensively. We knew what they wanted to do offensively.
Right.
You and I.
Yes.
They wanted to take the top off the defense.
And us alone.
Yeah. Take the top off the defense, take a lot of deep shots. They take a lot of deep shots because they got a lot of speed. Marcel Aitman, James Washington, a number of other big-time weapons out there. And it's like TCU was just totally unprepared and had no idea what was coming. Mm-hmm. Because deep shot after deep shot after deep shot, they got torched in the secondary.
Yes.
The defense did not play well. The offense, Trevon Boykin threw three interceptions, including a couple ugly ones. He did not look good.
No.
And perhaps most concerning for TCU is that Josh Doctson got hurt. And the entire offense changed when he got hurt.
It was bad, too.
He's so important to what they do offensively.
Very ugly.
Looks like he suffered some sort of wrist injury. We don't have any sort of word yet, but based on the replay, it looked gruesome.
It looked awful.
So
yeah.
He left, and I'll tell you, if they don't have Josh Doctson,
they're done.
They're done.
There's no chance that they can get through the rest of this unscathed without him.
I mean, he's so important to them. And
very.
I already think that their college football playoff chances
are torched. You'd assume. I think you and I feel pretty strongly that you have to go undefeated in the Big 12 to get out of this and get into the college football playoff, unless there is just a massive war of attrition everywhere else.
Well, especially with the kind of loss they had, that they went to Stillwater and no-showed. I mean, they got.
It was
smoked.
Not great.
It was really bad.
Yeah.
Okay. Sorry, I take a drink of water. I was getting a frog in my throat.
It's okay. All right. Sorry.
Number two, on the other side, staying in the Big 12, Baylor, and we mentioned this briefly on Friday's show, but it's worth mentioning when we do our three and outs. Baylor goes to Manhattan and kind of survives. I don't think they played particularly well, but I do think that Jarrett Stidham looked good.
Yeah.
They couldn't run the ball at all. Couldn't run the ball. The defense did not look good against what is a really bad Kansas State offense. And there could be trouble down the road. But it's a win, and you probably don't worry as much about Jarrett Stidham throwing the ball, but they got to get that running game going if they're gonna get where they want to go.
Yeah, I don't necessarily disagree. Boy, this is a hard one to figure. So the standard at this point is that going to Manhattan, playing that Kansas State team is weird. It's tough. No one seems to be able to just fly away from them.
Well, except Oklahoma.
Well, Oklahoma, yeah. And at this point, you and I are starting to wonder if maybe Oklahoma is the team that finishes the strongest.
You wonder.
And just sneaks away with everything.
They'll have their chance this weekend.
But I hesitate to look at that result and go, oh, well, Baylor's clearly not good enough.
No, I don't.
I don't feel that way at all.
I don't think that. But yeah. I do think that this raises a couple red flags.
Sure. I mean, look, if they had, you know, kept what they were doing and kept blowing the doors off people and added another skin to the wall, then sure. But
yeah.
A win's a win in a tough situation.
Yeah. It's a win, and it goes in the left side of the ledger. I'll say this. If they play that way this week against Oklahoma,
yeah,
or they play this week way the next week after Oklahoma against Oklahoma State,
yeah,
or against Baylor,
yeah,
or I'm sorry, or against TCU,
right,
they're not winning any of those games. So, the other one,
downer, Greg.
The other one, well, not to be a downer as well, but man, this is just a downer segment of three and out.
College is not a good college football.
Texas A&M, boy howdy, Texas A&M loses to Auburn, and it's an Auburn team I can't get a feel on because the way they played on Saturday, I wonder how they ever lose, because they were running the ball, they're getting push on the offensive line.
You know, the thing that I said last week. And it wasn't perfect because Sean White didn't end up playing because he was hurt. But, you know, you've got an offensive mastermind over there up against a vulnerable defense, and he Picked them apart.
He picked them apart.
I mean, Gus Malzahn did what Gus Malzahn does.
They started attacking the edges, and then once they shored up the edges by bringing safeties down, then they started saying, okay, cool, we're going to, you know, burst up the middle, and they did. And A&M had no answer, and then there's the offense, which,
well,
did not look good.
Yeah, no, I mean, it was like Alabama all over again when Kyler Murray came in. It was very clear Muschamp on the other side was going, okay, stay back there and pocket pass us to death.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and we'll Kyler see if you couldn't. Can do it. He couldn't. I mean, here's the thing. He looked like a freshman.
Yeah. And then he got knocked out by a dirty hit that didn't get called.
Yeah. Yeah, he did.
Which?
He did. I mean, I don't know. It was pretty. Yeah, it was pretty dirty. Not that
helmet
I think
to helmet, that. And he didn't even get a call.
Yeah.
And Ricky Seals-Jones is the guy that gets called on it.
Yeah. There's a. What's funny is that I didn't even see it because I was paying attention to. They kept showing the replay of Ricky Seals-Jones.
And you didn't even notice that the other
block.
One was crown to crown.
Yeah, I didn't even see it until like the 10th replay.
I'm
like,
so,
wow.
That's the other thing. This happened a lot in the NFL this week. I'm so over the headfirst diving into a sliding quarterback.
Yeah.
I mean, come on.
Yeah, if we want to have nice things like football, we have to make it safer. And one way to do that is to automatically penalize anybody who dives in headfirst at a sliding quarterback.
Foot first slide by a quarterback.
Yeah.
You're diving in with your helmet.
Yeah, I totally agree. Break. I totally agree. So those were my big takeaways from the college football weekend. What did you take away? Get involved with the show, #DCTFLive. The Big 12 looks like it's in flux. You know,
it was a disappointing weekend.
With Josh Doctson going down, there's big question marks around TCU. Baylor's okay performance in Manhattan.
Stidham's numbers were great.
Oklahoma rolled.
I mean,
Oklahoma State looked unbelievable.
Yeah, that disturbs me. I'm. I just hate the state of Oklahoma in general. So this isn't. This is not playing out well right now.
Yeah,
both of those teams are playing great.
It's a tough time for you. It's a tough time for you.
It's a tough time for Texans everywhere.
Yeah. Yeah. There were some other things across the state. I thought UTEP's win over Rice was on one hand impressive for Rice and on one hand impressive for UTEP, and on the other hand, what are you doing, Rice?
Yeah.
Houston gets the kind of ekes out a win over Cincinnati.
Cincinnati's a tough team.
Yeah, they are.
And it's kind of incredible that Gunnar Keel had the game he did while getting rocked constantly by the UH defense.
I've said it before, and I'll say it again. I love watching this Houston secondary operate. They're just a machine, and I love it. And it took a great quarterback performance to kind of pick them apart a bit. But, man, you get those guys flying. It is fun to watch.
Yeah.
And now they get their big test, which lost a little bit of luster when Navy beat Memphis this week.
Yeah.
But, you know, it lost a little bit of luster. But in any case. We are going to keep talking college football. We're going to talk to David Ubben, Big 12 superstar, guru, knows it all, about what he thinks. The thing about it is that I entered this weekend thinking that the team that I had the least regard for, the contender in the Big 12 that I had the least regard for, Oklahoma State, had the easiest schedule because they get Oklahoma, TCU, and Baylor all in Stillwater. Well, now, if they're going to do that every week in Stillwater, then they're a buzzsaw. And all of a sudden, are they the favorite to win the Big 12? Is Baylor still the favorite to win the Big 12? Is Oklahoma, who may be playing the best of all after their still baffling loss to Texas, are they the Big 12 favorite? I mean, It's all a mess right now. But here to help us sort out that mess is Big 12 insider David Ubben. Hey, David, how are you?
I'm doing good. Doing good. It's been an eventful morning, but I'm doing good.
It has been an eventful morning. A lot of things flying around. Let's talk a little bit of Big 12 football. I know you watched the TCU Oklahoma State game. Your overwhelming feeling about the state of those two Big 12 contenders coming off of Oklahoma State's rather dominant performance over TCU?
I think the biggest thing is you look at the Big 12, and it's a little bit more top-heavy this year than we've seen in a long time. And you look at them really not having a great performance outside of league play, not really any non-conference wins to write home about. You do the math and you look at the committee and you got to think that the Big 12 is going to have a real issue putting a one-loss team into the playoffs. So for TCU, they're going to need a lot of help to make that happen. But for Oklahoma State, I think certainly we saw them play up to and maybe beyond their potential. We'll see if they can keep that up the rest of the season. I mean, you can't ignore this is the same team that was down 17-0 to Texas Tech a week ago. But when they play like that, I mean, they're going to beat any team in the country. Just being dominant on defense, explosive on offense, that's tough to beat. And we'll see if they play up to that potential. Obviously, with them getting Baylor and Oklahoma in Stillwater, it helps them out. But it's going to be an interesting next few weeks for the Big 12. I think Oklahoma State clearly has the best win in the Big 12, maybe one of the best and most impressive wins in college football. And so they've got that on their resume, but it's only going to get tougher for them.
TCU loses Josh Doctson. We still don't really know how long he's going to be out. I know that the injury looked rather gruesome when it happened. Assuming that TCU is without Josh Doctson for at least a couple of weeks, what does that do to the TCU offense?
Well, I think it's certainly, I mean, it's obviously a big hit for them. I mean, Trevon Boykin is a great player, makes a lot of plays, but Doctson makes him look pretty good. I mean, they've got a trust in each other that when he's in single coverage, Boykin's okay throwing it up to him. I mean, the guy's 6'4". And he's 6'4", I think he's 6'2 or 6'3", but he's going to fight for the ball. He's got great hands. Nobody's better in college football at jump balls this season, sort of coming down with those. And he's obviously got great hands and a great vertical jump. And so he loses that ability. And I think Doctson, too, maybe a little bit of an underrated route runner. He's great at getting open and sitting down in the zone, getting open in the middle of the field. But, it hurts him in the red zone. I think that's where his loss is going to be felt the most. You saw when TCU had to go get some tough yards against Oklahoma State in the red zone, they failed. They couldn't convert a fourth down in the red zone early. Even late, they tried to go on fourth down and near the goal line, couldn't get it. Those tough yards in the red zone are always hard for spread offenses. And when you lose a guy that's that reliable in the red zone, I mean, you look at the Cowboys offense without Dez Bryant, it's basically the same thing.
Talking with David Ubben, Big 12 Insider here on DCTF Live. Get involved with the conversation, hashtag DCTF Live. David, I want to shift gears over to Baylor. They go to Manhattan don't look as dominant as they normally do. How much of that do you chalk up to the fact that it's a night game on Thursday night in Manhattan? How much of it do you chalk up to the new quarterback? What do you take away from Baylor's performance in Manhattan?
What's all those things? I think Kansas State, their offense is well suited to give Baylor some issues, and you saw that Baylor really struggled to consistently stop the run. I thought Jarrett Stidham played well, but still, you got to think that, especially in his first start on the road, his numbers aren't going to be probably what Seth Russell might have produced. And in the same situation, I think there's no question Jarrett Stidham's ceiling is higher, especially when you see him throw for 419 in his first start as a true freshman. That's really impressive. But I think, too, there might be an element of Baylor getting up 31-10 and feeling like they could coast. There's so many teams, and Baylor breaks the will of teams very easily. A lot of teams, when you get up 28-0 in the first quarter, and the game is not really competitive. I think we saw that happen to Baylor a little bit earlier this season against Iowa State, where they got up on a big lead early, and I think they took the foot off the gas a little bit. Maybe weren't as aggressive on offense. Got a little bit lazy on defense, and it came back to bite him in that game. There's probably a universe out there in which things go a little bit differently, and Baylor doesn't get out of there with a win. I don't think they were really happy about giving Kansas State essentially a drive to try and go win that game. I don't think that's what they had in mind. So Baylor, I think, has some issues with closing teams out a little bit, making things as convincing as they probably should be. I think there's some of that in play, and I think, too, Bill Snyder didn't deviate from what he does, and even though they were down, kept running the ball, kept doing what they do, and made Baylor pay for taking that foot off the gas a little bit.
Who has been, in the Big 12, who has been more disappointing to you, Texas Tech or Texas?
Well, there's no question. I think when you look at how they've lost games, You got to go with Texas. I think Texas Tech, we kind of knew who they were, and they've kind of been who we thought they would be. An offense that can put up a ton of points, and a defense that, while they've got better personnel this year, that personnel's still young. They've still got holes all over the place. It's a tough gig for David Gibbs. But Texas, you know, there's no excuse for them to get bullied by Iowa State, getting blown out, never really competitive against TCU. And especially when you look at just how good they can be. I mean, that Oklahoma game, I think, is going to go down as probably one of the more perplexing results of the entire college football season. And that's sort of who Texas could be and who Charlie Strong wants them to be. And when you see them put that on tape and you compare that to what they've put on tape in so many other games, whether that be the Notre Dame game earlier in the season or the TCU game or the Iowa State game, three games where they've really just been embarrassed, didn't look like they belonged on the same field, it's hard to be any more disappointed with a team than Texas.
We're talking with David Ubben, Big 12 insider here on DCTF Live. Get involved with the conversation, hashtag DCTF Live. David, one more question before we let you go. We're going to put you on the spot right now, and we are holding you to this. November 9th, we're putting you on the spot. Taking into all accounts all the tiebreakers and all that fun stuff, who wins the Big 12?
I'm going to stick with Baylor. I think everybody is probably going to take a loss. I think the Big 12 sort of doomsday scenario is kind of underway with TCU losing that game at Oklahoma State. I think that the best case scenario for the Big 12 was for Baylor and TCU to get to that Black Friday matchup, both undefeated. And if that's a close game, the Big 12 had a real shot to get two teams in the playoff. But now, I think with Oklahoma State, I still have questions about how good and how consistent they can really be. I still think they drop either the Oklahoma game or the Baylor game. I think Baylor, obviously, a tough matchup with Oklahoma this week. A team that runs the ball is going to challenge them, and they've still got to go to Oklahoma State. It's still tough for me to see everyone get through this slate undefeated, but I still think with everyone sitting there with one loss, I still think Baylor will emerge as the Big 12 champion.
He is David Ubben. He is the Big 12 expert around these parts. Yeah. Follow him on Twitter at David Ubben. That's U-B-B-E-N. I feel like I need to spell that. Do you find yourself spelling that a lot?
No, I think I just get Ubben a lot. Ubben. people seem to be very willing to ignore the rules of English and the double consonant that makes a vowel short or long. But hey, more power to him,
hey,
I suppose. I've stopped correcting people. I would say 70% of people go with the Ubben the first time they try. Right. I've given up.
Let me tell you, as somebody who's got two P's in his name, that's I feel you. I absolutely do. He's David Ubben. Follow him on
there
Twitter. We appreciate you, man.
No problem. Always good to be on with Greg Tepper.
There he goes. David Ubben, I walked right into that one. Yeah.
He beat me to it. I was going to make that joke, too.
I know. Yeah,
me to it.
You don't understand the struggle, man. I get a lot of Greg Tepper. I get a lot of Greg Tipper, Topper, Tapper.
I'm so sorry
it
for
is.
Your loss.
You
for
got
your
just
pain,
a you just got a boring
that
name.
You deal with
every
it
nobody.
Must be so hard to be a Twitter celebrity.
Nobody
whose name
ever.
Everyone mispronounces. No one ever calls you Tepper.
There are people who do.
No, there.
Yes.
Aren't.
Well, they're wrong. I'm telling you, they're wrong. Well,
obviously, they're wrong, but they don't exist.
Guarantee
there's no
you,
way they exist.
They do.
You're so full.
They
of
absolutely
it.
Do. Welcome in DCTF Live. If you're just joining us, we are here every day at noon on TexasFootball.com. You can also subscribe to the podcast on iTunes. Search DCTF Live on iTunes. I think he's right about the Big 12 doomsday scenario.
Yeah,
I think it's coming, and I think there's going to be a lot of wailing and gnashing of teeth when you've got Oklahoma at 10-2. Oklahoma State at 11-1, TCU at 11-1, Baylor at 11-1, and none of them get in. I'll tell you that especially Alabama's getting in. Okay, after what they did this week on national TV, and everyone saw that,
well,
they're gonna get in.
I mean, they might lose. You never know.
I mean, Clemson might Clemson. You know.
It doesn't look like they're going to.
Boy, they look good.
It doesn't look
Man,
like they're going to.
They look really good.
I don't think we're going to see that reborn in
Clemsoning?
Yeah, Clemsoning.
Clemsoning
sorry,
maybe
Dabo.
Dead.
If you're listening, Dabo, I'm so sorry.
Dabo's not listening.
Well, he's very angry if he is that we're even bringing it up. But
what, about Clemsoning?
you know, I don't think they're going to deal with a serious challenge until the semifinal at this point.
Yeah, I think that they are. I think they got past their big.
And you don't know. Maybe Dabo listens.
Maybe he does.
Maybe he does. Maybe he does.
Let's shift gears. Let's move on to high school. And we'll go three and out with the high school. My overall thoughts on the weekend. The first one has to be Pearland's win over Manville. What a win for the Oilers. They get pushed to the brink by Manville. Manville's got to feel like they gave it away, though. They fumble going into the end zone for what would have been the go-ahead score with about 2 minutes left. Pearland drives down. They line up. They look like they're lining up for a field goal. The lights go out at Alvin Memorial Stadium.
Bad timing.
Let's say that.
Bad timing.
Let's say that. At Alvin Memorial Stadium.
Yeah.
For the road team driving for
yep.
a game-winning field goal.
Don't know how that happened.
But they bang through a game-winning field goal as time expires to win the district. Again, there wasn't anything on the line, but for Pearland to finish unbeaten and to come away with a big win over the kind of elite team they're going to have to beat on a consistent basis to win a state title, I thought that was huge for the Oilers.
I think it's huge. I think you look at games like that, we had so many of those where not much was on the line, but it's two very good teams playing an important game. You win your district title. I wish it was a scenario where we learned more about these teams, and you feel like there's an element that you have to factor in when there's not anything on the line. If this is a win-or-go-home game, does it end the same way? It's hard to know.
Well, and what's funny is that I talked to Coach Ken Purcell on Fox Football Friday.
Yeah.
7 to 11 p.m. Fox 4 Southwest on Friday night.
Someone who has a lot of experience
sure.
with these scenarios.
Coaching.
Obviously.
And I asked him, I'm like, okay, so let's say you're coaching. There was another game.
Right.
Denton Geyer and Denton Ryan.
Yeah.
And Ryan came away with a great win. And I say, let's say you're coaching Geyer. And let's say Ryan gets up 28-7 in the third quarter. Do you think about pulling your starters? Because there's nothing on the line, anything like that. And he said, heck no. In a situation like that where it's a big rivalry game, you don't. And the other thing, you've got to teach your kids to finish the game. Because there's no risk of losing a player to injury is less than the risk of kids getting complacent, I think, going into the playoffs and thinking, oh, okay, well, you know, it's okay if we quit three quarters in. I think that's kind of...
It's hard to know. That's a weird mentality to understand. I've never been in it myself in sports, so I don't really know.
Number two on my three and out is... oddities in week 11, because it was a weird week 11.
It was very,
you,
very weird.
You had the lights go out in Pearland. Yeah. You had
That was nothing compared to everything
else. You had Vandegrift lose to Georgetown, although a very scary situation. Yeah. Paxton Seguina, their star wide receiver, had to be care flighted out. But I did talk with Drew Sanders, the head coach of Vandegrift, and he said that he's doing fine. He's doing better.
And Paxton apparently tweeted out that he's doing well,
that
too.
Is
so
outstanding. That's the best news of the day.
Worst feeling in the world when you hear one of these kids being air flighted.
I know. It's really kind of stunning. You had a team win its first game of the year. You had a team snap a 23 game losing streak in Salado. They snap a 23 game losing streak, beat Smithville, and get into the playoffs.
Yeah.
They beat them 28-21. You had a ludicrous day for San Antonio Roosevelt.
Yeah.
I don't know if you saw the numbers for their quarterback.
Just a bit gaudy.
Let me pull this up real quick. He is up for our Mr. Texas Football Player
of
the Week.
If he doesn't win, it's a ripoff.
If he doesn't win, we probably need to stop the poll.
It's on the Roosevelt community for not voting enough if he doesn't win.
Bryson Carroll goes for 351 yards and 8 touchdowns rushing, which would be crazy if we stopped right there.
Yeah.
He also added 218 yards and 2 touchdowns through the air. A huge game for him. It was a weird, you had Odessa Permian lose San Angelo Central. San Angelo Central looked great. The defense, like, lived up to what we thought it could be against a great Permian offense. I was really impressed with San Angelo Central. You had a team win their first district title since 1993 in Rising Star down in the six-man ranks. They beat Blanket 30-28. It was just a wacky weekend.
San Angelo Central's video was that win was by far, you know, the biggest win of the weekend for me. Mm-hmm. I did not think they would put up a fight against Permian, and they did, and more. And now I don't really know what to expect from either of them in the playoffs, but it'll be interesting.
And that is number three on our three and out. It's the playoffs.
Oh, wait, the playoffs are starting. The playoffs are starting.
Really fired up. It is the playoffs. It is week 12 now. You can check out all the playoff pairings. You can check out all the brackets up on texasfootball.com/playoffs. That's texasfootball.com/playoffs. We have been slaving over our computers.
We didn't get very much sleep this weekend putting that together, so please use
Thank
it.
Thank goodness my wife was out of town.
Yeah.
Because I picked her up at the airport last night, and I said, it's a good thing you were out of town, not because I don't love you, but because...
no time for you.
You would have felt totally neglected this weekend. Because I just sat there on my computer and go... all weekend. Because it's just a big data dump.
It is.
And...
so much information.
I don't like giving competitors, although it's a friendly competition, credit on statewide air. So mad Matt Stepp beat us to it.
Woj.
It was like 11 a.m., and it's 11 a.m., and I'm kind of plowing through 6A rankings and stuff like that. And he tweets out, here's all the 6A matchups and stuff. And I'm like, crap.
I don't think he sleeps, man. He's always talking about getting on flights at like 4 in the morning.
And
he's flying down to McAllen. The guy's a machine.
I tweeted at him. He's over at the old coach. He does fine work over there. And I tweeted at him and told him, golly, I was so upset that he just beat us by like an hour. And it's only an hour. And in the grand scheme of things, it's not a huge deal. But he had it. And I'm like, ugh.
Yeah.
Just like I said, hashtag stay woke.
Yeah.
You gotta stay woke out there. The streets are hot.
Well, it's frustrating because he's got so many connections. He's great at combing every source he has. I started Friday night by just searching the Texas High School Football hashtag on Twitter, because you'll just get all these pairings will just start popping up and you just record them as they come.
Mm-hmm.
And still, the next morning there's Matt Stepp with the pairings just one after the other.
Just a jerk. Machine. Yeah, I know. Anyway,
I was so proud when he had his 2A's up and I had my 2A's up and I had two locations that he didn't have yet. I was like, my small victory.
It is, of course, a very friendly rivalry.
He must have had a lunch.
He must have fallen asleep for a second.
He must have taken a nap or something. I got him on two locations.
Yeah. So it was a wild week 11. And now we move on to the playoffs. Again, texasfootball.com, all the brackets, all the... all the pairings. We will have our predictions up on Wednesday, so tune in for that. Mm-hmm, and starting tomorrow, actually, we're going to do our bracket breakdowns on DCTF Live. Each day, we're going to take two brackets and break them down. 6A tomorrow, 5A Wednesday, 4A on Thursday, and then we'll
and
do
then
the
four on Friday, right?
3A and 2A on our hour-long show on a Friday.
We're not going to break down the six-man bracket, Greg?
I mean, I will. If you want me to.
I'd like to.
I'll tell you.
We might make up for it by sneaking out to a 6A game on Thursday. That's the hot rumor around the office.
Yeah, I'm down. You don't have to ask me. Yeah.
I'd like to do it.
What is that game that we're going to go to? So
it's out in Springtown.
It's out in Springtown. And I'll tell you, it's Gordon and Bryson.
That's right.
Gordon and Bryson are playing. Gordon's going to be a heavy favorite in that one, but it's six man. And it's at Porcupine. It's at Pojo Stadium. It's at Porcupine Stadium.
Tempting.
Yeah. I'm in. If you want to go, 7:30. Thursday. We have all the pairings up, texasfootball.com/playoffs. But this is the most wonderful time of the year. It's the fun. I made the point yesterday on the show, or last week on the show, and then I made it again on Friday night on Fox Sports Southwest. I will take last week and this week over the state championship weekend. And that's not because I don't love state championship weekend, because we get to hang out with our buddies and see everybody, and it's kind of a big, it's kind of a big party. But... and, of course, there's great high school football games. But the quantity of win-or-go-home games that happened last week and this week, it's just such a cool, cool thing.
Your brain will melt.
We're waiting to be joined, hopefully, by Jeff Hulme, the head coach of the Mansfield Tigers here on DCTF Live. Follow us on Twitter at DCTF. Like us on Facebook, facebook.com/DaveCampbells. Follow us on Instagram, instagram.com/DaveCampbells, and at texasfootball.com. We're waiting for his call. He should be calling us, although let me see if I can find a phone number for him if he doesn't call you so that we can bother him. Mansfield looks great. Running back Kennedy Brooks is a machine. He's a cyborg at this point, what he's doing.
Kenny Brooks puts up ridiculous numbers. I try to put together our ballots for Mr. Texas Football every weekend.
Every week he's out.
Every weekend. He's 300 yards, no big deal, just and at a level that is very hard to rush for those numbers.
He's not doing it on a six-man field, you know what I mean?
Not even to take anything away from the guys at the smaller level. It's just, man, the kinds of defenses he's going up, the size they have, impressive.
It is. And he's a big reason that they beat Cedar Hill. He's a big reason that they are that they are going into the playoffs rolling. They look very, very dangerous, and that is a team you do not want to stand in the way of right now. Let's see if we can find who they're. So they're going to play in the first round. They've got Colleyville Heritage. It's going to be a tough game, but they get him at home, and that's a key thing. I'm sure that if and when we get him on the phone, I'll ask him about. I'm sure he loves the home field advantage thing.
Yeah,
I've heard mixed reactions from coaches, but I imagine he's like, "Oh, I'll take it. We'll play it for a Newsom Stadium. That's fine."
Yeah, no question.
Then they will get either Keller Fossil Ridge or Marcus. You got to think Marcus is probably a favor there, but that'll be a tough game. And then it's going to be a team like Abilene or Arlington Lamar, Wolforth Friendship, or Eastwood, and then at that point you're into the regional final. And
these are all pretty good matchups.
Everything's coming up Millhouse for Mansfield. We are efforting to get Mansfield head coach Jeff Hulme on the phone. He said he'd call us. If you know Jeff Hulme and you're by him right now, say, hey, you're supposed to call DCTF Live. But it should be fun. It's the most wonderful time of the year. We are very excited about the playoffs. Should be buku of fun. And I think we've got him on the phone. Let's see. We're trying to get him on the phone. Hold on. No, he's don't. See, Max is now like talking with him, trying to become best friends with Jeff Hulme. That's my job. I want to be best friends with Jeff Hulme because his team's really good. We are pleased to be joined on the phone now by the head coach of the Mansfield Tigers, is Jeff Hulme. Hey, coach.
Hey.
How are things in Mansfield?
Well, we're still practicing, so things are good.
Well, yeah, absolutely. You know, I imagine, we take for granted, I think, with four teams making the playoffs and teams, everybody makes the playoffs. But I imagine that for a coach, this has got to be a satisfying moment that you check one of your boxes off of your checklist.
Well, yeah, I agree with you. I think some of the people back in the days where they only had one team going, they do look at us and go, oh, wow. But, I mean, it's still hard. I mean, golly, I mean, there's some good teams in our district that aren't going to playoffs. And, Duncanville being one of them. And so, I mean, it's hard to get in there.
Mm-hmm. It sure is. And you guys ran through, you mentioned a gauntlet of a district, the key win, of course, that everybody talks about being your win over Cedar Hill. What did you learn about your team to go and beat the two-time defending champs? What did you learn about your team from that game?
Well, I mean, that's a good question. I think the one thing I learned is, they never give up. I mean, there were several lead changes throughout the game. We had a couple of bad things happen to us on special teams-wise, and yet we were able to persevere and win a close game. And I think that, that's exactly what we just got to be talking about in our team meeting, was some of these close games in district ought to be able to help us in the playoffs because, we're getting the playoff. We shouldn't panic if it's a close game and go from there. So I think, the biggest thing we learned is they're going to lean on each other, not panic, and, it's a full four-quarter game.
He is Jeff Hulme. He is the head coach of the District 8-6A champion Mansfield Tigers, joining us on DCTF Live. Coach, obviously the headlines around your team start and end with your outstanding running back, Kennedy Brooks. As a guy who gets to see him operate every day, what sets him apart from some of the other running backs across the state?
Oh, well, I think part of it is, we were in there lifting weights just about 30 minutes ago, and he's in there lifting weights, and he's had, 200 carries, on the year and 2,300 yards rushing, and he's not beat up.
Yeah.
He doesn't take a lot of full hits. I mean, he's very smooth in his running, but when teams get a beat on him, I've never seen anybody tackle him really hard. And I think that's been part of, you know, what's helped him, you know, really since game five from last year until now. I mean, he's been a beast of a running back. And, he, you know, knock on wood, I mean, he has been able to stay healthy all this time.
You guys ran through a gauntlet of a non-district schedule as well. Flower Mound Marcus ended up being, you know, one of the better teams in the area. You guys beat Hewitt Midway and then drop a game to Mansfield Summit. For you, when you, and obviously it's not entirely your call, but when you're putting together a non-district schedule, how important is it for you to get teams that you think are going to challenge you on the schedule?
Well, I think it's very important. You know, I mean, it depends on how many you play, whether it's four non-district games or three. I mean, you want at least two or three of those games to get you ready for district, you know, especially in the district we're in. You know, you look at the two teams we lost to, they're combined 18-2. You know, they're both 9-1. And you know, obviously, you know, Summit's 5A, but, I mean, they're 200 students below us. And so it's not like they're a small 5A. And it's a good rival game. But Marcus is, you know, typical Marcus. They were big. They pushed us around a little bit and really got us focused on what we need to get better at. So, you know, from that standpoint, it was really good. And then for us to finally break through and get after Midway, you know, they've beaten us three times in a row. So that was a satisfying non-district win, no doubt. But to play the teams we play week in and week out in our district, I think it helps out, you know, tremendously.
What, you know, it has been a banner year for Mansfield ISD in general, between y'all, Summit, you know, Lake Ridge. What's in the water?
Well, you know, I think it's a, number one, I think it's a great community to move to. I think people recognize that, you know, the good schools here, you know, academics are important. We've got a great superintendent who was an ex-coach. And so athletics are important. And, you know, I think when people are looking at places to move, they're like, you know, Mansfield is it's not in the middle of the Metroplex. It's out of the way a little bit, and yet it's close enough to things. And so it's a very good, you know, place to live in the community. I mean, we've got five high schools, but it doesn't feel that big. It doesn't feel that spread out. So, I mean, it's just a, you know, it's just a neat place to live.
He's Jeff Hulme, the head coach of the Mansfield Tigers, joining us on DCTF Live. Get involved in the conversation, hashtag DCTF Live. Coach, one last question before we let you go. You open the playoffs against a feisty Colleyville Heritage team that you know is well-coached with Joe Willis. You draw them at home. You draw them at Vernon Newsom Stadium, and you may be a little biased because you are the beneficiary, but what do you think of the pilot program of in 6A of teams that are able to play at home?
Well, like you said, I'm biased because I'm playing at home. You know, if I was in Joey McGuire's seat, I might be singing a different tune having to go to South Lake. You know, to be honest with you, I don't know. Because obviously the home teams like it and the teams that don't. You know, I think in a way it's good because that person, the number one seed, has certainly earned it. And in the past has really been no benefit to being the number one seed, to be honest with you. But in the same token, I do like that, except for the state championship games, that most games are decided between the coaches and they're picking neutral sites and stuff like that. So I like having a little bit of the power back in, it's, you know, deciding that stuff. But I don't know. I mean, it's, you know, it's got its pluses and negatives, obviously. You know, it just really depends on where you're sitting with it.
I suppose that right now, I imagine you're in favor of it. But if the shoe were on the other foot, maybe. Maybe not so much.
Oh, there's no doubt. There's no doubt about it. You know, I would certainly not be looking forward to going up to South Lake. You know, they got some magic up in that stadium.
They sure do. They sure do. Well, let's hope that you guys have some magic at Vernon Newsom Stadium on Friday night. He is Jeff Hulme, the head coach of the Mansfield Tigers, joining us on DCTF Live. Coach, thanks so much. Best of luck the rest of the way.
Hey, I appreciate it, guys. Anytime.
There he goes. Jeff Hulme, head coach of Mansfield. Kenny Brooks is something else, man. Candy
he can run,
something
man.
Else.
He is. Can run.
And, well, and that's funny that he mentioned that he never takes a big hit because I've mentioned on this show about some of the players that I've really admired in high school football, like Kyler Murray and Braylon Addison. One of the things that set them apart was that somebody taught them early on to take a hit on their terms.
Right.
And if you've got a running back of that caliber who is able to effectively take a hit,
I mean, that's an underrated skill. A very underrated skill.
Yeah,
he
for
is,
sure.
He is...
Well, that's... Actually, it's sort of unrelated, but in a way it is. We talked a lot about Kyler Murray this weekend. Mm-hmm. You know, being his size and worrying about him taking big hits. But generally, guys that are quick, guys that are shifty, some of them just have a knack for not getting hit like that, you know? So...
Mm-hmm. It's he's a unique running back. He's a unique running back, and he's a big reason why they can make a deep run. Now, what I think is funny, not funny, but interesting, you know, they could face Marcus in the second round, a team that they lost to already.
It's a gauntlet, man.
I mean, and I'll tell you, Caldwell Heritage ain't going to be any pushover.
No.
They got Kevon Ahmad, who's an outrageous wide receiver.
Yeah.
And you know they're well coached with Joe Willis.
Yeah, you got to think that they feel like they're on the up with a coach like that.
Yeah, it's going to be fun, 7:30 p.m. Friday night at Mansfield's Vernon Newsom Stadium. It is Mansfield taking on Colleyville Heritage. This is DCTF Live. We are here every day talking football in the state of Texas. Every weekday, I should say.
That's true.
Every weekday talking football in the state of Texas at noon on TexasFootball.com. We go for an hour on Mondays and Fridays. We go for 30 minutes Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. Try to get some guests on that you guys will find interesting.
Oh, and we got one coming up.
We have my hero. I mean, to be real honest, he's my hero.
Sure.
Craig Way is my hero. He is the high school football overlord.
Yeah.
Okay.
He's a knowledge machine we should all aspire
to
be.
He knows everything about everything.
Yeah.
Interested in talking with him about some of the key first-round matchups, what could come down the pike. And, of course, his beloved 25-5A. He loves 25-5A. And there's a lot to love. Cedar Park, Vista Ridge, Vandegrift, Georgetown. A lot of good teams there. He is, of course, also the voice of the Texas Longhorns. So that's kind of his straight gig. He's also a radio host. It's nice of him to make time for us. And the host of High School Scoreboard Live. He's the hardest working man in showbiz, is what it is. He really is. So we're going to be talking with Craig about high school football playoffs here in just a moment. Want to invite you to follow us on Twitter at DCTF, like us on Facebook, facebook.com/Dave Campbell's. Subscribe to the podcast on iTunes. If you ever miss a show, it'll get onto your phone or your other listening device. And how about that? Joining us on the phone line now is the voice of the Longhorns, the host of High School Scoreboard Live, the guru of high school football in Texas. It is the great Craig Way. Hey, Craig.
Hey, Tep, how are you?
I'm all right. Happy playoffs.
Yeah, it is that time, isn't it? Like I was saying the other night, it's great to have that kind of Christmas present, that package you open up, and lo and behold, you're headed for the postseason, and here's who we're playing, and here's where we're going to be, and let's get it on.
I want to ask you about some first-round matchups. Obviously, South Lake Carroll-Cedar Hill jumps to mind as a real battle of heavyweights in the bi-district round. What other games in the first round of the playoffs are particularly piquing your interest?
That certainly sticks out to me. You brought that up, and it has all of the glitz and the glamour of what those two programs have accomplished over the years, what they're still accomplishing, what Cedar Hill is trying to accomplish to add on to back-to-back. That in itself, I think, is pretty exciting just to hold. But there are other good ones. Longview Lufkin comes to mind. Mm-hmm. And we've already seen how those two have gotten after it. I think there's some good East Texas matchups and a couple out in West Texas as well. When you go down the classification ladder and you look at some of those, some of the smaller ones too, there's a couple that might stick out and go, hey, that might be pretty interesting for a round one matchup. But certainly for 6A and 5A, those are two that just kind of leap off the page at me.
I asked you this on Friday night, and I figure I might as well get a retread of a question. Take your pick, state championship weekend or this weekend, maybe combined with last weekend.
You're asking me to choose between two children.
I know I am. I know.
They're both wonderful in different ways. And by the way, I'll add opening night to that.
Mm-hmm.
It's like three completely unique children, so to speak. And I've got four kids, and unique doesn't even begin to describe them. But Opening night is special because you've waited and there's been all the heat of those two-a-day practices and all the work and all that stuff leading up to that. So you have that to start with. Then you get to what we now refer to as week 11. It is the 10th game for everybody, and it ends after that. And so there's that. And there's that mystery, there's that suspense, there's that angst as to who's getting in, how are they getting in, or could it be coin flips, could it be positive points, could it be plus minus, could you have something really goofy like what happened in 13-6A where you have three coaches walk out to the 50-yard line and flip a coin, or could you have a 27-5A with that really weird thing and the way that all worked out with Lockhart and San Marcos, you know, so it has an extemporaneous quality to it that none of those other weeks have. And then, of course, state championship Saturday is the pinnacle, and it's been all of that work that everybody's put in, and it finally comes down to those final games over those final 3 days, state championship Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. So they're all unique in their own way. They all have their special quality. And there's a little bit of, and you know this as well, being on the set, there's a different kind of energy that permeates what you're trying to get accomplished. You know, when I'm in the broadcast booth on the championship days, it's very, very plotted out, and then you just let the game unfold and you call the game. On that Friday night of week 11, stuff's happening on the fly. When I was just getting into the studio and found out there was going to be this three-way coin flip in 13-6A, and coaches were going to walk out, when I heard Pflugerville had won the flip, the first thing in my mind was, we got to get a hold of George Herman. We got to get him on the phone. So your mind works differently. And then we were scrambling, and sure enough, Coach Herman's a great guy, and we got him on the phone. And, you know, so it's the way that you mentally dial into the events of the day differs week one, week 11, and then the final week, the state championship weekend.
Craig, I'm going to throw a scenario at you. You're in the press box. You're calling that Lockhart game, and the quarterback runs into his own end zone, waits for the defensive tackle to run toward him, and then gives him the football. What do you say?
Well, hopefully, if I've done my job, I've prepared myself for that moment, that the possibility of something like that. And not to go on a big tirade here, but as bizarre as that was, I completely understand why they did what they did, because it's all about, you have to do what you have to do to get to the next point. I don't put it on them. And really, I don't fault the district executive committee for not having farsightedness on that thing, because who can plan for that sort of thing? What think, though, is that we need to get rid of negative points in a points tie-breaking system. It's when you get into the minus is when all the craziness really starts happening. You know, there was controversy enough in 13-6A about whether Hendrickson should have been included to break the three-way tie for seeding in between the two Division I teams, and Hendrickson was going D2, and Round Rock had won the head-to-head against Cedar Ridge, but it didn't even matter because they included Hendrickson in the tiebreak. Those are the kinds of things that have to be sorted out in advance. And like I say, I don't really fault them too much in terms of not having that kind of farsightedness, but now we have test cases for it, and maybe they should step back and say, maybe the negative points thing doesn't work as well. Maybe we should try to go positive points only.
He's Craig Way. He's the voice of the Longhorns, the voice of high school football on Fox Sports Southwest, joining us on DCTF Live. Get involved in the conversation, hashtag DCTF Live. Craig, I look at the brackets, and are there any teams that you feel like are maybe not overwhelming, but clear favorites to win a state championship? I know one or two springs to mind, but I don't want to poison the well here. I want to hear what you have to say.
Two come to mind. Canadian and Navasota.
There we go.
I just think they have clearly proven on a week-in, week-out basis that they are at the top of the heap. Now, having said all that, remember, and you'll remember this, Greg, last year Navasota posted numbers that were equally, if not in some cases, more impressive, and then they wind up having to go double overtime and get a weird call to kind of help them out in that win over Argyle. So once by the time you get to that fifth or sixth ball game, things can get a little crazy. But standing as we are right now, getting ready to go into the postseason. I think those two, if you had to say it, would be like the, you know, the if you had to say were overwhelming favorites, A, to win, and in their cases, B, to repeat, it would be those two. Now, I think Cedar Park is playing the best football of any 5A team in the state, but we also know 5A is chock full of fantastic teams, so there's no guarantees for the Timberwolves either.
He's Craig Way. He is heading to Morgantown this weekend to call the Texas and West Virginia game. Do you have the rest? I know you like to take in about 50 different high school football games. Do you have your schedule planned out for bi-district weekend?
You know what I'm doing Friday night?
No.
I'm calling the basketball game that Texas is playing in Shanghai, China, but I won't be in China. I was originally scheduled to go to China. Mm-hmm. And maybe I made the Chinese government nervous. I don't know. No, but but what happened was there was some miscommunication. The Pac-12 conference, which is the host conference, was supposed to set it up for not only the Texas radio broadcast crew, but for their own host institution that's playing there, Washington. Texas is playing Washington. For their radio network to go, there were some major problems with regard to J-9 work visas and broadcast equipment being transported, and the Chinese government finally said, yeah, no, they're not coming. So what's going to happen is Friday night, I'm actually going to be sitting in the radio football broadcast booth in Morgantown calling a basketball game being played in Shanghai, China, between Texas and Washington.
He is the hardest working man in sports media in the state of Texas. He's Craig Way. Follow him on Twitter at CraigRay1. Craig, happy playoffs, my friend, and enjoy Shanghai via remote.
Well, as I said, you know, whether I was in Shanghai or Morgantown, you know, West Virginia and China are both foreign countries. So, you know, that was fine. So, you know, I'm ready for either way. So thanks.
Thanks, Craig. Appreciate you, man.
You got it.
There he goes, Craig Way. Voice of the Longhorns. That's insane. He's going to be calling the Longhorns basketball game from Morgantown.
The wonders of modern technology.
It's really quite remarkable. I should have had him. I know he's down in Austin. He was just at the Charlie Strong press conference. I should have had him talk to Vince Young and tell him.
Let him know that he needs to pick up his award.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. And with that.
Oh, is that the end of the show?
I guess so. Thank you to David Ubben. Follow him on Twitter at David Ubben, UBBEN. Thank you to Jeff Hulme, the head coach of the Mansfield Tigers, and thank you, of course, to the incomparable Craig Way for joining us on DCTF Live. Follow us on Twitter at DCTF, like us on Facebook, facebook.com/Dave Campbell. Follow us on Instagram, instagram.com/Dave Campbells, and, of course, see us at texasfootball.com. I really feel like that's a missed opportunity.
Oh.
I really do.
The campaign goes on.
Vince Young, please come get your Player of the Year trophy, and we will see you tomorrow on DCTF Live.